Hey everybody, and welcome to my special 1 year anniversary show. I am so excited to be here with y'all. DJ Poe, thank you for hosting. Jeff, thank you so much for rating. So what we do on the show is we do live music recording and production, kind of in the post-punk, something domain. Today we're going to be working on one of my new solo projects, a brand new thing, that is tentatively called The Light Grew Strange. Now, before a studio session, I will like go and kind of sketch things out a little bit and kind of get some general ideas of where I want to go. So I thought I would start just by, playing y'all a snippet of the sketch that I had done, and then we're gonna go in and do the actual live recording, rebuild a song live, and go from there. And also, for the first time, y'all are gonna get a straight up performance. I'm gonna play a song for y'all, and should be fun. Okay, so here's what we have as a sketch for The Light Grew Strange, and this is the song we're gonna be working on today. Here we go. Picking guitar in there. And we've got a nice big guitar coming in right here. And this is also live bass. It's really loud live bass, but yeah, so this is the general idea of what we've got going on. I don't normally play live bass because I kind of feel shy about it, honestly. Yeah, we're gonna get some of that done. So y'all want to jump right in and get going on some music? Let's add a track. We're gonna start out with a drummer track because we want some kind of rhythmic foundation that we can play along to. Okay, so let's go with Max, who is punk rock, and we have what kit do we have? East Bay kit, that sounds good. So this is kind of a step up from a drum machine, and it's programmatically generated percussion, and you can tune it using the controls down here. So let's start out with something kind of simple and kind of soft. Let's see what we've got. All right, so that's a nice kind of easy. Then we're gonna step it up a little bit as we go on. So again, we're not gonna spend a whole lot of time on the percussion track right now because we're just laying down just the basics, just something we can play along to. All right, and that's sounding good. And then we're gonna go in this third pass, we're gonna go kind of loud and complex, and let's add some splashes in there, and let's crank up the fills. What the fuck. All right, so we're gonna go from here. That drum kit is pretty plain, so let's put just a touch. Let's try maybe a room mic. Here we go. Let's hear that. That's better. And let's put just a touch of reverb on it. And we're gonna be doing something special with reverb later today. I watched a really cool documentary, and it was talking about this really important studio that opened up in 65, and some of your favorite musicians recorded there, and I'm gonna actually play something from that. So, all right, what does this sound like? That's okay, but I want some more low end, so let's go into EQ. here. Okay, and again, let's not spend too much time on that. Let's just get the basics. So I'm going to copy those three drum parts, and we're gonna put it back in. We're just gonna paste it in a while until we have enough runway to do our next part. All right, what do y'all think with starting with a bass? So let's, we'll add a new instrument. We're gonna take the input as the bass. All right. And y'all know I like to color coordinate my tracks, but in the interest of getting shit going and not losing y'all, we're just gonna do it here. All right, so let's maybe get a nice spacious bass tone. And yeah, we're gonna jump right in. So this is my Lakland hollow body bass. Has a nice, really nice rich tone. Kind of a boutique brand. Really like it. My friend and collaborator Panda Brand recommended this this pedal to me. So. All right, what do y'all say we play some bass? I am so tangled up in chords right now. All right, and we're just gonna do a couple passes and just see kind of how it feels, and we'll go back and do a proper performance. So let's see. Wow, Logic just completely crapped out. I've never seen Logic crash like that before. Wow. Okay, let's see. Thank y'all so much for the hype train. You are way just so kind. I really appreciate it. Okay, come on, Logic. Okay, we have our bass track. And let's set the puppy to record. Let's go. All right. So that's the basics, and the upbeat part we're gonna go. Okay. I'm gonna quit that. All right, let's do another take. That is pretty good for a start. And all right, so so many guitars. All right, so I just recorded a few measures worth because I wanted to like get a foundation for us, and we're gonna end up looping the bass just temporarily while we continue building out the song. So let's paste it in a few times. All right, we've got about 5 minutes worth of runway now. Oh yeah, there's the tone we want. Let's turn that gain down some. And one thing I want to point out, just kind of like a composition note. So the bass for the first couple of passes is soft, right? Well, it's like low energy. And then here, where the drums pick up, the bass picks up as well. But listen to what happens next. The bass continues playing the active part while the drums have gone back down in intensity. So that is intentional, and that is part of the storytelling. Y'all might know one thing I really try to do when I'm composing is tell a story. Every song tells a story, right? So the different way that I arrange the elements, the energy, the ebb and flow, the rise and fall, that's all part of the drama of the story. All right, we're gonna add a little finger picking part next. And for the first time, we're gonna debut my acoustic. So we're gonna go to acoustic guitar. I don't remember which one I used. Here's a sweet finger pick. All right, So this is actually the first acoustic guitar I ever got. It's an Ovation, and the Ovation started in the 70s, and the interesting thing about the Ovation is the back of the body here is actually fiberglass. It has a really, really nice bright tone. It's active electronics, so got a little battery in here with a little bit of EQ. And sounds kind of nice. And that's way too much gain. Let's drop that down some. Okay, so let's see some finger picking. And if y'all know anything about music, and of course you don't have to, but if y'all know anything about music, you know that, shit, I just completely dropped my thread. About the chords. We're doing a D minor to A major progression. But y'all know how I do with guitar. We gotta play some heartbreak chords. We've gotta get some complexity and some tension in there. All right, so how about we get started here? And again, we're just gonna do a really rough take just to kind of get the general idea down. So here we go. And I'm going to be playing the chords pretty straight, probably for the finger picking part. And then we'll add some of those heartbreak chords on another guitar, maybe the Damien. Oh, and for those of y'all who sub, there's a brand new Damien 7 emote. That's the guitar with the bats on the fretboard. So, okay. Give that another shot. I think I want to start. I want to come in right on the beat, so. All right. Some runway there. That acoustic, just that tone is so nice, isn't it? All right, let's give a listen to what we have so far, see how it feels. Shall we? Thank you. how that's coming along. We're gonna do some kind of a some can't spell finger picked guitar. Okay, let's add a little bit of synth into it, and just maybe a pad, a little something, just to kind of support things. Nothing too distracting. So let's go with maybe Sodex strings. Let's see. Okay, and let's bring that way down. Everything's like jacked up. All right. All right, and we're just gonna play a simple kind of a two-chord progression. All right, let's go. That's just kind of low and it's kind of supportive. On this are killing me. Okay. I think that patch might be a bit much. Let's try unstable strings maybe. Come on, Logic. Yeah, that's a little bit more moody, isn't it? Okay. Place to start. Let's see how it feels. Really appreciate the y'all who stuck around. I'm gonna copy that. We accidentally recorded over our guitar part, so here we go. On the beat, we did have one. There we go. I think this is okay. All right. We're going to quantize, which means we're going to programmatically put a filter on things here. And I want to bring the velocity up on everything. Velocity is basically how hard were the keys hit. And let's do that at about 113. And see how that feels. of a iambus here. How does that feel? Next up, we will record the other guitar part, but I do have something special planned for y'all today, as it's an anniversary show. So this week, I watched a documentary called Rockfield, the Studio on the Farm, and it told the story of these two brothers, the Ward brothers, Kingsley and Charles. And so they were farmers. They came from a farming family, and they're in the middle of nowhere, Wales, near a village called Monmouth. And 1965, the two brothers inherited the farm, and farming wasn't really doing it for them. So they had kind of a wild idea. They said, what if we built a music studio in the attic, just kind of on the whim? And back in the 60s, almost all of the recording studios were owned by record labels. So if you were not a band that was signed to a label, it was very, very difficult for you to record and put out music. So this was like a godsend. And sometime around there, I can't remember exactly which band it was, but one of the bands that came to record wanted to spend like maybe a week or two there, and there was no room for them in the village of Monmouth. So Kingsley ended up putting them up in an extra room in the farmhouse, and that gave me the idea of creating what's called now a residential studio, where bands would come in and stay for a week, 2 weeks, in one case even I think like almost 3 years, and the bands that went through Rockfield. Absolutely amazing, starting with bands like Hawkwind, through the 70s, Queen recorded Day at the Opera there, I believe, and Freddie Mercury even composed parts of Bohemian Rhapsody there. But of course, in our Twitch community in particular, we have a lot of 80s music that we're very, very fond of. So 1982, Bauhaus actually spent some time at Rockfield and recorded most of the songs for the album The Sky's Gone Out. The band recorded several songs there. I can't remember the names of them. And just all sorts of amazing bands, and they were active through the 90s as an active studio, and these days they're kind of a bed and breakfast kind of deal for music fans. But watching this documentary and seeing all those bands, I had it on the TV and I had it up really fucking loud, and there was a sound. To a lot of the music that was recorded there. And interesting bit is that Rockfield was a very, very low-tech studio, and they didn't have a lot of like electronic gear and a lot of production equipment. They just basically had really good mixing desks. So for example, if a band was there and they wanted some reverb on the vocals, they would actually, they had a room in the stables that they converted that was essentially an echo chamber. In fact, they had three of them to get different reverb sounds. And some bands even recorded outdoors in the stone courtyard, which has just this amazing, amazing, amazing acoustics to it. So I want to play just a couple of sample tracks. from some different bands that recorded there. Let me bring this over here. Why not? Dave Edmonds, this is 60s music, but listen to the tone. Sounds like it's in the room, and I don't really care for that music. So how about Queen? Here's an example track they recorded at Rockfield. Now I don't know what y'all can hear versus my ear. But listen to that acoustic guitar. There's just like a little bit of what we call room noise. It sounds like it's somewhere in space, right? It sounds like it's in a room somewhere. We have the Damned with Smash It Up. That same kind of like presence to the guitar. It feels like it's in a space. And Ballads from a Sky has gone out. That acoustic. I don't know if y'all can hear that, but I can hear it, and it's amazing to me. And then getting into music that, you know, I don't really like that much, but it's a good song. Overplayed to death, but it's a good song. Coldplay actually recorded their premiere album, their debut album, rather, at Rockfield. And the lead singer, guitarist, leader of the band, wrote some of the lyrics inspired by literally being outside in the courtyard with his acoustic guitar. All right, do you hear that? You hear that presence? So one of the things we're gonna try and do today is recreate some of that Rockfield sound, with what we've got going on in Logic for this new song. But first, I did promise y'all that I would be doing a live performance for the first time. So I'm going to play one of my favorite Bauhaus songs, very understated Bauhaus song, but one that I've always really enjoyed, and actually one of my first songs that I actually learned on guitar back in the mid-90s. All right, so I hope y'all will stick around for an acoustic version of Three Shadows, Part 1 and 2. And let's see here, gonna use a different mic. Give me 1 second. Test, test. All right, we're good. All right, all right. And, no, I may fuck it up. Okay, I'm working on it. And see what we can do. Hopefully y'all can be okay. Thank you.
classic gentle mood.
Hope y'all enjoy. Hope y'all enjoy.
I have never done a live performance on here before. I hope y'all liked it. Might end up doing that again sometime if it wasn't completely and totally awful. All right, y'all. We are about at the 45-minute mark, and I wanted to take a short break. Normally we have the Twinkie break, the delicious. Cream-filled golden snack cake, but let's actually listen to something from my back catalog while I have a short break here. So this is from an album that I put out called "Not the Worst of a Little Fire Scarecrow." I was making music from 96 to 2000 with mainly me, with some other folks occasionally, and a lot of it was shit, frankly. So I went back over 4 years. I had written like 85 songs, I think, put out 8 albums, and I picked just 8 tracks that I don't hate, that I think are, let me be kind to myself, I think they're good. So I want to share one with y'all while we take a short break here, and this is called St. Anthony, and this also is one of the earliest songs that I wrote on guitar. So hopefully y'all enjoy it. Okay, let's spend the next 4.5 minutes with me. Y'all stick around, okay?
Saint Anthony.
I like that song. I like that song a lot. So I just plugged in the Damien, and y'all might know if you've been here before. Someone actually in one of the DJ chats mentioned Strike Fat Guitars, and I had never heard of the brand. So I went to the site, and the first guitar I saw was this guitar, the Damien 7. And it's got a really nice tone, a lot of sustain. Strike Fat kind of specializes in like heavy rock, hard rock, heavy metal kind of guitars. The tone is really appreciated and sustain's really appreciated. But y'all, the selling point, look at this. We've got bat inlays on the fretboard. And that just makes it like the ultimate fucking goth guitar as far as I'm concerned. All right, so Logic is giving me trouble again. Let me reboot Logic real quick. And we're gonna record some big guitar on it. I do have the I have the St Vincent handy as well, which has the whammy bar. But I'm not sure if we want to use that today. So we're gonna start just with the straight Damien. Oh, the other cool thing about the Damien, most guitars are six strings, and can't remember the company. One guitar company came out with a seven string in the 90s, and it was like really hard to play. It didn't really work. They're kind of coming back into vogue, and so you get an extra bass string, that B down there. All the rest of them are the normal strings you get on a guitar. It lets you do, lets you go a little bit deeper. For this, we're gonna start bringing in that tension, some of those kind of fucked up chords that I do. And let me see if I can find them. I do a lot of kind of weird chord fingerings, and I started down that path because I am, surprisingly or embarrassingly enough, not really good at bar chords, where you put a finger across to raise the pitch of all the strings. So I ended up finding, there are chords that I literally couldn't play, so I ended up finding different fingerings for them further up the fretboard, and I kind of like the way that goes, because you get, so here's the straight chord, this is a D minor, but I'm playing it up here. So we've got some different notes in there. We've got that, we've got what I call those heartbreak notes. And that's probably going to be kind of loud. Let me maybe bring that down some in the mix. Not too much. Make sure that as I'm recording, I can hear everything else. Yeah, I think that sounds nice. Do y'all want to record some guitar? The microphone picks up the sound of me drinking. I hate that, but I'm thirsty. Okay, let's go. Thank you. exactly what I wanted to do with it. We're just kind of getting the idea down. So I want to hear how it sounds. There. All right, let's try that again, shall we? Always miss this. Let's work on the tone just a little bit. I don't want to get too distracted with it, but I do want it to sound like it's coming together. So let's see here. I'm gonna loop in one of the active parts just so we can kind of hear what it sounds like. That is pretty low in the mix, and I think what we're experiencing here is the two guitar parts kind of clobbering each other. So if I solo just the finger pick guitar and the distorted guitar, Thank you. All right. Do y'all know about flavor crystals? Back when I was doing some study of how different musicians that I like compose, I watched St Vincent, Annie Clark, masterclass, and she talked about what she called flavor crystals, which are like those little flourishes, those little touches that you add a song just to give it some character. They're not carrying a melody, they're not doing anything like that. They're just adding a little bit of character. And I do love me some flavor crystals. So I was thinking we might do something with a synth, and I have some kind of like noisy, kind of interesting kind of synth sound. So let's call this track Flavor One. Why not? Really creative. And let's find a nice kind of, maybe some kind of shriek, maybe some kind of maybe a glitchy thing. Let's see. Come on, Logic, don't clown ball on me. I don't know why Logic is being so flaky today. Alright, I used that one before. And Logic, come on. Right. Want something a little bigger than that. Maybe? Nah. Want something really... Ooh, sideways metal. Oh yeah. There we go. All right, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna shift everything a little bit to the right, and we're gonna come in with that synth before everything starts. So let's give that a shot. Let's get something really ugly. Yeah, kind of dig that. Performance characteristics out of that. So we're gonna bump everything a little bit more. Excuse me, I'm in Logic right now. And all right, let's make some awful noises to start this song out. And we'll do some production on it. We'll put it in space. We'll dry it up a little bit, but let's get going. So close there. All right, let's try that again. I love this sunset. Okay, let's see what's going on now. Try it one more time. Yeah, I'm doing the mod wheel over here. Just shaping that sound for me. Yeah. let's dirty that puppy up some. Cool, cool. I did not record. What the hell? Guess we gotta do that one more time. Things go wrong. It's normal. Let's grab part of it and we're gonna loop it and let's do some effects on it. I don't wanna, I'm picking on a, oops, got a quantizer. Okay. Should we leave it more spacious? Lower volume on the flavor crystals, yes, yes, yes. Let's drop that pretty far down. We'll be right back. know why. Grab everything. Oops. Grab everything. Not grab that one. I'm gonna slide these over. I don't know how they got messed up. All right, try that again. About doing some automation, and automation is basically exactly what you would do if you were writing a mixer live. And what I want to do is I want to fade the flavor crystal, that shrieking synth. I'm gonna fade that in a bit. So we have our gain here, in that lane, and let's see, we bring it up about at the halfway mark, and we just kind of come in a little lower. Should we maybe go up a little louder there at the end? What do you think? Let's try it. Not that much. Okay. Whatever you want to call it, where everything kind of picks up here. Oops, right about here. It's hard to follow the bass. More or less. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna cut here. Cut that finger pick guitar part, and just for that, we're gonna mute it there and see how that feels. All right, we're not gonna go all the way back. Oops. So let's just get it coming in. Let's see how that feels. We'll be right back. And it's not quite right. We'll do some more work on that. I want a little bit more bass. We'll do something to kind of fill up the mids. Taking out that finger pick as far as brought that out. Okay. Set that synth a little bit in more there. So we're coming up about a little over an hour, I'm not quite sure if we want to do more with this song today. Don't really want to get too deep into it, but maybe let's add another layer of guitar in that quote-unquote chorus. So let me put a marker here. And this, we're just gonna call it B. And we'll do a marker here, which we will call A. Intro. And here we'll do A. All right, and let's hide the shit we don't want. All right, so let's add another layer of guitar. And I don't know what kind of sound we'll go for. I just want something a little bit fuller in that B part. So we're gonna cycle that and give ourselves some slop on either end. And why don't we do something with the St. Vincent? I think that'll be fun. So we're gonna have a loud popping noise. Sorry. And we'll bring up the St. Vincent. So the St. Vincent, I've talked about before, it is a guitar designed by Annie Clark for Ernie Ball. It's an Ernie Ball Music Band St. Vincent Special Edition. And this is like probably the nicest guitar I have. Not my favorite, but it's close. Let's see what we wanna do there. And I might experiment a little bit with that whammy bar. Let's just see what happens here. Let's give it a patch. Let's go with a little crunchy guitar maybe. Just give it a shot, see what happens. So I'm having a little bit of trouble here because I'm hearing a delay, and that is kind of fucking with me trying to stay on the beat here. So if it sounds off, that's why, and we're gonna try again. And we're gonna do some complementary chords here. That delay is really killing me. All that kind of gave me an idea. We're not going to have a lot of production here because we are just getting our first draft done. But I do wonder if we want to do something with these two guitars to make them maybe a little bit more spacious, take up a little bit more of the stereo width going into that B part. So what I'm going to do is we're going to do some more automation, and what we're going to do is pan. So starting with that first guitar, we're going to have it in the center channel most of the way. But we are going to shift it to the left channel, kind of hard. And we're going to do the same thing with our second guitar, only the other direction. So we have our pan animation here. It's pan center right now. So let's pan that puppy equally in the opposite direction. And that widens the stereo field, and what that means is it basically makes the sound wider. We're going to more, we're going to either side of the stereo channel, which is kind of widened it out. So let's give it a listen just to those two guitars. We'll solo those two and see how that feels. That first guitar is over in the left channel. Alright, so another thing we can do, just that circle is in over here. For the second guitar, I think we're going to do a different patch, and we're going to bring in some more different. To make guitar a little bit more complicated, we're actually doing a pitch shift on this, and we're blending the pitch shift. So now I'll try it again. So we've got some fifths in there just to bring some interest. We're coming up at the bottom of our second hour, and I think that's about what we're going to do today. Let's give it one more listen through, and then we will take off. Mods, please tell me who would be a good channel to raid after that. Go ahead and drop it in chat, and let's listen to what we have.
Thank you.
this is kind of the second half of the B part, and but the drums drop down in intensity. So we're doing, we're doing some different dynamics. So what if we shift those pans back to center for that part? We're close to center, and kind of bring some focus back in. Let's see how that feels. Do the whole thing one more time. That in a mix. Today is just about getting some of those bass parts down, basic parts down. All right, y'all, really appreciate you being here today. Thanks for putting up with me. Thanks for sitting through my rendition of Three Shadows Part 1 and 2. I will be back next Sunday at 3 Central Time, and hopefully, y'all know I'm doing a collaboration with the folks from Eloquent Steven and DJ Rasker. And one of the songs we're working on is a cover of the Sydney Lauper song True Colors, which is a real, real, real challenge for me because it is a very, the music is very like kind of uplifting, kind of like an anthem, kind of like a ballad in all major chords. And I don't do well with major chords, even though this song here is in an A major. So should be fun, and I'm bringing in some interesting samples, kind of connecting it to some stuff that's contextually appropriate to my world. So should be fun. So Randall will hopefully be guesting. So you'll see him on a split screen with me, and he'll be giving me feedback and guidance, and we'll be swapping ideas and kind of seeing how it goes from there. Be sure to tune in next week. I really appreciate y'all. We're gonna raid Greg House, and let's get the typing correct, and thanks again. We'll see y'all next week.